okay?
I suspect the silence means I'm supposed to start. Is that right? Okay, welcome everybody. Or should I say, welcome to the Institute of Education. Those who are already employees of the Institute of Education, thanks for having us. We're here today to celebrate the launch of what I think is an absolutely fantastic, brilliant new guided reading scheme. I would say that as I'm the publisher of the aforementioned scheme. My name is Eddie Rippeth. I'm the head of primary publishing at Cambridge University Press. Before I go on, I've got a couple of bits of I'll stand over here. There's a couple of bits of housekeeping. First of all, apparently there's no fire alarm set to go off, no practice, so if a fire alarm goes off, That means there's a fire, therefore please do go to the nearest exit, which I'm told is just out there and to your left, okay? There are toilets just out of the door if you're turning left, obviously if you need those. There is a Wi-Fi URL if you want to plug into your Wi-Fi, which is IOE_Cambridge_reading_scheme. I've missed an underscore there. IOE_Cambridge_reading_scheme. Well, what has brought the Institute of Education, this is a world-leading educator of teachers, together with Cambridge University Press, which, believe it or not, is actually the oldest surviving publisher in the world. I could say it's the best publisher in the world, but then I'm biased and it might not be true. I think it's true, but there you go. So to mark our launch, we've got a whole range of people who are potentially involved in Cambridge Readers. Obviously, we have people from Cambridge University Press here. We have people from the Institute of Education here. We have authors and illustrators who've created the reading books, but we also have from Netley Primary School a number of children who we hope will be the future users of the books, and obviously the teachers from Netley Primary School will also be the users of the books, we hope. So thank you everyone for coming along. It's a particularly proud moment for myself and also with Sue and Glenn, because we've been on a bit of a journey which has taken several years to get this published. It's been a bit of an adventure. It's been included knockbacks from certain other publishers. Obviously, it's been through a merger here at the Institute of Education with UCL, and all kinds of things. And from my personal standpoint, it's taken me to places around the world to meet various teachers and various children around the world to find out what they want to read about. Now, it's easy for me to say this is a very special scheme, it's unique, but what I'd like to do is explain exactly why. First of all, this is basically the first properly international guided reading scheme. By that I mean these books are designed for children in places like London, but also places like Bogota, Jakarta, Dubai, Bangalore, Jakarta again, Kuala Lumpur, every place, every city you can conceivably think about, we think these readers are the perfect books. The reason is that we've chosen a range of topics and subjects which we think will appeal to the international children of the 21st century. So we have topics like the environment and wildlife and such like, it's a recognition of the fact that time has moved on from cosy western suburbs that you'll find in certain other reading schemes, and actually we have deliberately depicted international schools, international settings, traditional stories which from all sorts of traditions around the world, such as Arabic or Indonesian or Chinese, and by getting such a huge and varied range, we're also making sure that these books have terrific variety but also terrific beauty, and we've done that by going to the very best authors, many of whom are here today, and the best illustrators. So we have a lovely set of books. I hope you'll all have a chance to actually look at the books. They're all around you on the posters, as you'll see. They're behind me. There's boxes of them around. Please do stop to have a look. One quick point, why hasn't this been done before? Well, for the past few years, global education has changed quite dramatically. In many schools around the world, children no longer just learn English, they actually are starting to learn in large numbers in English. So even in places like, as I say, Bogota or Jakarta, where there's no particular link with Great Britain, children are starting to learn their lessons in English. Until now, these were called international schools, and they tended to take hand-me-downs. So they would take schemes designed purely for British children or American children or Australian children and use those in their class. However, many more of these children now are from the back, are actually from their native country. Therefore, they want something which is a bit more relevant, a bit more engaging to their needs. So we've done this. That's one of the key mantras of the scheme. However, if it were just left it there, it would just be a range of books. In order to turn this into a proper reading scheme, which will work as a really effective instructional tool, this is why we've worked with Sue Bodman and Glenn Franklin at the Institute of Education. They obviously have an outstanding record in teaching children to read, so they were the best possible partners in this venture. And I'd like to hand over to Sue and Glenn so that they can tell you a bit more about how that was achieved. So thank you.
Wimpy Kid Old School.
Oh, wow. And is it a good story? Why are they good stories then? What makes a good story? Somebody else give me an idea of what makes a good story. Any idea? Any thoughts?
It's too hard.
Oh, is that a hard story? Is it about somebody exciting? Is it about somebody exciting? Is it about adventures? Well, we've got the right books for you then. Let me show you my favourite story. My favourite story is called Football Boots. And the reason that this is my favourite story is because it's a really exciting story. Do you know, in this story, Tifo wants to get in the school football team, but he doesn't think he's very good. So his granddad gives him a pair of lucky football boots. And Tifo plays football really, really well. But one day, the football boots get chucked in the bin by his mum because they're old and dirty. How do you think Tifo felt when that happened? Any thoughts? How would he feel if he's lucky? Yes, you tell me.
Sad.
Yes, you're right. He felt very sad and very, very worried because he's not sure if he can play football well enough. In this story, there's a happy ending. And that's one of the reasons I think you're going to like the stories in our Cambridge Reading Adventures, that all the stories have characters in them that have a really happy ending. They have to sort something out for themselves. And I really wanted to know what happened to Tifo in this story, because a lot of the books in the Cambridge Reading Adventures are about the same group of children in school. And it's about what happens when they get together with their friends and something happens. Maybe, like in this one, everybody's worried that they'll be late for school and the children have to sort that out. In the end, it's the teacher who's the one that's the late one. And that's good, isn't it? That's funny when the children are there before the teacher. In this one, they lose one of their fluffy chicks and they have to find out where the chick is. And you know, it's the children that find the fluffy chick. In this one, Omar spills a great big jug of water all over the artwork. But do you know Omar is such a clever character that he finds a way to sort it out before the teacher thinks of it. So my favourite stories are where the children sort out the thing that goes wrong. They are really good characters. So just like when you told me about Ruby, stories about Ruby, the children in this book, in these books, are really good at sorting things out. And I really like the pictures. I'm going to show you some of them. The children in this story have an exciting classroom, and we really get to see some of the action. If you like football, you'll be able to see that this picture really helps you understand what's going on in this football match. So this is my favourite book in the whole series. I wonder what yours will be. Will it be a book about a girl, a bit like your Ruby, or a boy that has an adventure? And you're looking at some of the pictures here, maybe your favourite book will be about some of the animals, or some of the children in different countries, and lots of having adventures there. Maybe it'd be a book about beautiful places. All of the books in this series have really good stories, and we hope you enjoy them. That's why Glenn and I wanted to work on this series, because we wanted to have some really good, exciting books for children. I'm going to hand over to Glenn, who's going to tell you about her favourite book.
Hiya. Hello. Right. How'd you get here today?
Bus.
On a bus? You came on a bus? I thought you were going to walk. Great to see you. Sue was telling you about stories, wasn't she? Yeah? But do you know what? Cambridge Reading Adventures doesn't just have stories. It's got lots of information books as well. Who likes information books? Lots of people. What I'm going to ask a few people what you really like finding out about. Show me on your face if you're ready to tell me what you really like finding out about. I can see there's an interesting face. What do you like finding out about?
Magnets.
That's an interesting one for any future authors out there. What do you like?
The sea.
The sea. I've got one for you in a moment. Right, what do you like?
The Stone Age.
The Stone Age. My goodness, we'd have thought we'd have gone to talk to you a lot, because you wait to see what I've got here. What do you like?
The solar system.
The solar system. Wow. Well, I've brought some of the non-fiction books, the information books, that are in Cambridge Reading Adventures. Just some of them, because as Sue said, there are 90 books in the series. And half of them are non-fiction, so there's a lot of information. Somebody said about prehistoric times, didn't they? We've got animals of the Ice Age. Wow, look at that. What's that animal on the front there? What is it? It's a mammoth, isn't it? Big woolly mammoth. And this book will tell you why he has lots of fur. Lots of really fur. How many of you have got your own mobile phone? Even at your age, you've got your own mobile phones. Well, we've got a book about mobile phones in Africa. People using their mobile phones. Who said they like the sea? It's one for you. Look, Giants of the Ocean, whales. Fantastic book. Another prehistoric one. Who knows what they are? Who can read that really tricky word on the front there? What are these? Pterosaurs, well done. Funny old phonics there at the front, isn't it? With a P and a T right at the front there. Pterosaurs. Now I'm going to ask you, we've been talking about non-fiction, about information books. What do non-fiction books usually have in them?
Information,
you're right. What else do they have? How do we know it's a non-fiction book and not a story? Sue was telling us about stories. How do we know? I'm going to come. How do we know? What do you see in a non-fiction book?
A contents page.
They always have a good contents page, don't they? What else do they have? How do you know it's an information book?
An index page.
Index page. We'll have a look in a minute, see if there's an index. What else?
Glossary.
A glossary. I wonder if there'll be a glossary in my book. I'll have a look in a minute. What else do they have?
Fact box.
They have fact boxes. We'll have in a minute. See, these books have fact boxes. One more thing. What else do they have? Titles and headings, don't they? You are absolutely right. I'm going to...
Headings.
Subheadings. Now, we're going to have a look at one of the books in the Oxford... Oxford in the Cambridge... Apologies for that. Goodness. In the Cambridge Reading Adventures. I've got a book called Going on a Plane. You folks at the end there, who's been on a plane? Have you been on a plane? Yeah? Where did you go? Did you? Where's your country? Tell me. Where is it? What's it called? Oh, you come from Kosovo. I bet there's. I bet you've been on a plane back to Kosovo. You've all been on planes, yeah? What's your favourite bit of being on a plane?
What's your... When it goes down and up.
And your tummy goes all funny, doesn't it? Yeah? What's your favourite bit on a plane?
Looking down when it went really high.
Oh, it makes you go dizzy, doesn't it? What's your favourite bit?
Flying.
Flying. Wonderful, isn't it? You told me that books have certain things in them. I'm going to put this phone down just so that I can have two hands on the book.
Right. Well, thank you very much, Sue and Glenn. That was wonderful to see the array of books and see your enthusiasm for these fantastic books. Next, I'd like to introduce one of our best authors. His name is Ian Wybrow. Now, Ian's famous for a number of books prior to Cambridge Reading Adventures, although this will make him 10 times more famous, we hope. But he's famous for Harry and the Bucket Full of Dinosaurs, Sniff, is it Little Wolf? And he's going to be running a special workshop about storytelling with you shortly, but he's going to have a few words first. So here, ladies and gentlemen and children, here's Ian Wybrow.
Hello, hello. I don't know if you're receiving me. Is this working or not? Yeah? Good. Just checking on this microphone. So, children, I just need to check one or two things. I've got to ask you some hard questions. First of all, what do we call the people who write books? Anybody know that? Yeah. What is it?
Illustrator.
An illustrator. He's the illustrator, not me. What do we call the people who write books? Do you know that?
Author.
The author, yeah. I'm very pleased you knew that, because I once went into a library and the librarian introduced me and said she was very excited because we had a real live author, and the little boy in the front row said, "Oh, what a shame," because he thought I was an orphan. Right. Now, what do we call the people who do the pictures in books? Yes.
Illustrator.
Absolutely. This is Alan's the illustrator, I'm the author. I had a nice time. I went to a posh school in North London, and I asked the children, "Come on, what do we call the people who do the pictures?" They went, "Ah." I said, "What is it?" And they said, "Australians." Well, we're not Australian, but Alan is the illustrator. I don't do the pictures, I just do the stories. I want to talk about books and why we bother to read them. I think the best thing, the greatest gift that your mum and dad can give you, apart from a bit of love and a bit of food, and how many of you got television in your room? Thank you. And anybody got a computer in their room? Yes, okay. Right, hands on. So I think the greatest gift they could give you is a love of reading books. And I was very lucky because my mum, my dad was a sailor, he was always away, but my mum, while he was away, would read stories to me all the time. And she would read Alice in Wonderland and The Jungle Book and Winnie the Pooh and stuff like that, that I really enjoyed. Nearly always stories about people, children maybe, animals, who have difficulties about one thing or another. They find it hard to get on, but in the end, they come through and they triumph. And I like those sort of books. And I can't remember in detail much about them. I can remember one or two things. I can remember from Alice in Wonderland, when Alice says, "You are nothing but a pack of cards." And she's talking to the king and the queen, who are very, very bossy. I remember that. And I can remember some of the verses, because my mum is very good at remembering poems. "Speak roughly to your little boy and beat him when he sneezes. He only does it to annoy because he knows it teases." Well, I remember that. I remember the king asked the queen and the queen asked the dairymaid, "Would you like some butter for the royal slice of bread?" The dairymaid said, "Certainly, we'll go and ask the Alderney, but marmalade is nicer if it's very thickly spread." Now, I don't know where I learned that, but my mum used to do that and it sort of stuck. So I think that's what happens if people read to you. What I remember most of all about my mum reading to me is the pleasure that she took while she was reading to me. And that is what I think made me a reader and probably made me a writer too. I never had any difficulty with reading or writing. It just came naturally because we all like books. My mum liked them, me, and I, my sisters liked them. So can I just ask you, has anybody ever seen, have you ever seen your dad reading a book, enjoying a book, hands down? Anybody ever seen your mum reading a book, enjoying one? Okay, right. We'll have a little chat about that later. Look, even babies enjoy books. If you're an author, people write to you and they say, "Could you do us a book about babies?" You say, "What's the point? They can't even speak English." Okay, go on, do us a book. So I've done a book for a baby. You get hold of the baby and you say, right. You know what babies do when they get hold of books? First of all, they give them a little suck. Have you noticed that? You say, "No, don't suck it." But they like to suck them. And then they try and screw them up. And then, well, it takes a long time to train babies with books. You have to train them to manipulate the pages and turn them like that, open them up like that, like that. And then, this is the way we go. It takes about a year to train a baby. And if they can't speak English, you think, well, what's the point of reading to them? But so I tried this with Ella. You ready? Ready, ready, steady, off we go, round the farm to say.
Hello.
Have you read this?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll turn it over. Who's that nibbling, half asleep? Say hello to the dozy. Elephant? Sheep. It is a sheep. Can you see the pictures? It's a sheep. All right, let's just hang on. Ella, do you want to say hello to the sheep? No, right. Well, what did the sheep say? I spent all this time writing this nice book, and she says, rah. Right, let's try this one. Here's the sty, not very big. Say hello to the little pink pig. What does the piggy say, Ella? Rah. But then I thought, well, this is a bit of a waste of time. But then if you say to a little baby, what does the sheep say, Ella? She just hears a little tune. She hears like that, and she thinks, ah, when he makes that tune, I gotta make a noise. Now, she didn't know that cows go She didn't know that horses go. She didn't know that giraffes go. Listen, that was a little series of records, say hello to the animals. I didn't know what giraffes went, but we decided that they would go, lick, lick, when they hit. I don't know if they make a noise at all. Anyway, the thing about books is, you can taste them, you can hear them, you can smell them. They're not like screens. You can't suck a screen. You can't hear it. You can't smell it. And you can't kind of work your way through it in the way you can work your way through a book. So that's babies like them. Did you know 80% of parents never have a conversation with their children? Now, I discovered that because it's Professor Winston who's told me that on Children of Our Time. 80%. And you think, have your parents ever had a conversation with you? Hands up. Who's that? Oh, thank goodness for that. What he means is, this is a parent having a conversation. Look, you are not wearing those to school. Just go and put your school shoes on. Thank you. Alan, have you brushed your teeth today? Good boy. And how did you get on at school today? Were you okay, right, fine. Yes, you can have one of those, but you've got to eat that first. This is not a conversation. This is two lorries on the M1, and they've got the lights on, and they see another lorry coming. Flash, flash. That's a conversation. I'll tell you what a conversation is. I was reading a little book of mine to Fifi, my granddaughter, age 2, and I thought, this is a very educational book. She'll really love this one because she's got to answer questions. Here's a page. Breakfast, the children all want to be fed. Show me some eggs and some milk and some bread. Right, I'll just show you how brilliant these children are. Who can show me where the eggs are? Can anybody tell me where the eggs are? Where are the eggs on there? Where are they? Oh, wait a minute, I'm gonna ask somebody. You're just too intelligent, I'm not asking you. Right, come on, who knows where the eggs are? Can you tell me? Where are they? In the basket, brilliant, you see, it's so good. And there are lots of ways of saying, oh, it is on the right-hand side of the page, just above. You can develop language through books. But anyway, I thought, I was so pleased with it. And I said, well, come on then, Phoebe. And she said, is that one dead? What? And she pointed out there's a little blue rabbit under the table here, which I hadn't actually noticed, but the illustrator had thoughtfully put it in. And is that one dead? I said, well, I didn't like to say anything then. I carried on with the story, but later on when we were having a bath, I said, Fifi, what was that about the rabbits? She said, in the road. And I remember we'd been driving through Norfolk. And in Norfolk, which is in the country, all the rabbits wait in just along the hedges. And when a car comes along, they throw themselves out in front of the cars and get squashed. And I said, oh, Fifi, don't worry, because rabbits are very silly. They don't look, and they don't hold their mummy's hand when they cross the road. They don't listen out for the cars. So there I was, having a conversation with a 2-year-old about death. Now, how often do you get a chance to do that? Only if you're sharing a book. That's what I'm suggesting. It's slightly off-piste. It wasn't even in the book. But an opportunity arose to talk about it. So there we are. Stories then offer a kind of emotional literacy, which means to say, children, that if you're a bit worried about something, like dying, or if you're worried about dogs, or what are you worried about? I know what you're worried about. Spiders?
No.
Oh. What? You don't have to tell us. What are you worried about? About what?
Going on a plane.
A lot of people do get a bit worried in case it crashes, you mean? In case, yeah, I know what you mean. Well, I think if you're worried, maybe about dogs or crashing or getting lost or being in the dark or not understanding things, not being able to say things properly, all those things you might be afraid of. But if you read a book and look, there it is in the book, you realize you are not alone. there are other people in the world who feel afraid like you and who can get over it, get over it too. So that's something that books are very good for. And you might be a bit nervous in case you're a bit too naughty, but you know, naughtiness is very good in books too, because it gives you a chance to see what happens, what the consequences of being naughty are. Anybody read Horrid Henry? Yeah. Sorry about that. Okay, hands down. Good. That's very, very encouraging. If you go into most primary schools, you know, the children say, I don't know, I don't like books. What am I going to read? Read Horrid Henry. That's what they say. There we are. But yes, I read a book about a small wolf whose mum and dad didn't think he was quite bad enough. You can explore language in books. You can find new vocabulary. Anybody discovered a new word today? Have you got a word that you have never written down that you know? Can you think of one? Can anybody think? Do you know the word abominable?
Abominable,
not abominable. Well, who knows the word abominable? No, I discovered that when I was your age, when I was 8. I heard it when I went to church, and the vicar said, somebody was an abominable sinner. I thought, abominable? I put it in everything. I put it in all my stories. Today I went on the 52. It was abominable. And Miss Salt said, that's great. Where did you get that from? Oh, I just learned it. But I think you've got to read and listen. If you want to extend your, if you want your to find new words to put in stories, you've got to read. Okay. Repeating things in books helps you to establish the rules for thought, beginning, a middle, and an end. It's how we learn reasoning. It's how we learn how to write. You need to read so that you pinch ideas to write your own stuff. So what are we going to do about your dad who doesn't read? I tell you, I've got a suggestion for getting them reading. I'm always getting asked to go into schools, could you get our kids reading? The answer is no, I can't. I can show them Harry and the Bucket Full of Dinosaurs, which they all know, don't you? And they enjoy those, but they will possibly read those together. But unless you see somebody that you love or admire enjoying a book, you're never going to read a book. Oh, you're going to think, oh, they tell us about doing that at school, but it's not real life. Mum and Dad just watch the telly. They're all right. Well, you and I know they're not all right. They're sort of half all right. But I tell you what we're going to do tonight. I would like you to go home. I'd like you to say, Dad, I haven't noticed you reading a book lately. Why is that? And he'll say, well, I'm very busy. I've got a lot of things to do. So you say, yeah, but can we go down to the library? And I'd like you to get a book. And I'll get a book for you, a book for me. And maybe we'll get a book that we could read together. And then you could start a little conversation and tell each other stories. And I think that would be a very good thing. Okay.
Me.
You'll go.
Authors. I need the...
you need this. Oh. Wait a minute.
I've got it. Alan Rogers here.
Give us a chance to get untangled.
The thing about Alan Rogers is a lot of us actually grew up with his animations on television. So he's something of a legend in the world of children's illustration. Known for things like Pigeon Street, Words and Pictures, and things like that. And it's wonderful, obviously, that he's also illustrated a number of our books. So when Alan's got his microphone...
Wait a minute.
Okay.
We might need a techie here. Try that.
It's... Alan illustrated a particular favourite of book from the scheme, which was Diego Fandango, amongst one or two others. And he's going to tell you all about illustration, and he's also going to be doing an illustration workshop soon. Okay, so Alan, you ready?
Yeah. Can you hear this? Am I loud enough?
Yeah.
Shout. It's these authors, they go on for ages.
I know, sorry.
Yeah, we want to get drawing some pictures actually, so I shall make it fairly short. But I've illustrated three of the books, and since there's 90 in the series, I realise that I've just done a tiny amount really. So I've illustrated a lot of children's reading schemes, literacy books in general, but actually what I've done most of is make animated films for television. So I've made lots of children's films for TV, BBC and Channel 4, and well, on Channel 5 actually, thinking Nickelodeon. The point about what I've found myself doing is that I've been drawing pictures to try to persuade children to read, which seems a bit of a contradiction, really, because you can look at the pictures and you don't need to bother to learn to read. You could just look at the pictures, work out the story. And before I could read, my favourite thing was to go through the newspapers. And I used to look for all the cartoons, the jokes. And I quite like the comic strips where there were three or four pictures that told a short story. And the reason I liked them was because actually there were a sequence of pictures you could often tell what the joke was without reading any of the words. But I realised there were words underneath, and sometimes there were words in the speech bubbles. And I started to find out that I actually didn't know the names of the characters without reading. And I didn't know what they were saying. And sometimes what they were saying was the funny bit. I would just laugh at the pictures quite often. But that wasn't the joke. Actually, what they were saying was the important thing. So you put the words with the pictures and you've suddenly got a whole story. But I think the reason I started to learn to read was so that I could tell what the joke was and so that I understood what the sequence of pictures was about. I think we all get into reading for different reasons, and somebody was saying they wanted more information. So if you're interested in dinosaurs or planets or food or whatever you're interested in, you can find out about it that way. But for me, I think I always wanted the story, and I don't know why, but I think we can never get enough stories, can we? Whether it's on film, in a book, or whether you're just talking to other people and they tell you a story. I think for some reason, we seem to all want lots and lots of stories. So I think one of the things is I've written some notes, which I haven't looked at yet. And the reason I've done the notes is so you know I can read. I didn't have this reading scheme when I was learning to read. I had it was about two characters called Dick and Dora. And I think other people had Janet and John or Peter and Jane but my whole thing about these books for me was that they did a lot of running and jumping and sitting on mats with cats and dogs, but there was no real story in it. And for me, oddly, that made me want to read faster. So I had to learn to read quickly so I could get off the Dick and Dora books and onto the proper stories. And so I did. That was I think for me that was my way into reading, was first of all looking at the pictures, wanting to know more about the pictures. And I'd like to think that when I do a book, you could look through the book and you could probably work out the story from my pictures. You probably wouldn't need the words, but you wouldn't know what the name of the characters were. You wouldn't know what they were saying. And very often at the end, they say something quite funny. So it would be, you'd be missing all that if you couldn't read the words. So for me, I suppose, I think it's the two things together that I really like. I like the words and the pictures. And sometimes I make the pictures move, and sometimes, as we're going to do in a minute, they stay still. So I think everybody's talked for long enough, and I've probably added a...
Interesting.
Yeah, there's nothing else there. That's me done. And we're going to have some drawing. And I think actually before I think we're going to divide you into two for some reason, probably because there's not enough chairs. One of the books I did was Diego Fandango, which is that one over there with the flamingo who's playing a banjo. And I seem to always get the ones about animals in the jungle. And I really like doing those because I like the idea of drawing a picture of something that couldn't happen. I don't know if you've ever thought about a flamingo playing a banjo, but they would have a real problem. And I quite like the idea that I can do one. I've done, for some reason, I've done quite a lot of animals playing instruments. I've done a horse playing a banjo, and they've got big hooves and they can't actually strum or even do the frets or anything. So what we're gonna do in the interesting part of today is that we're gonna draw some pictures, and I'd like you to think about an animal and an instrument, and we're going to try and put the two things together. So your favorite instrument, your favorite animal, or your least favorite animal, your least favorite instrument, whatever you fancy, and we're going to have a go at drawing an animal with an instrument. And we could do a whole band, because that's what happened in Diego Fandango, but I think we're going to concentrate on doing one. So that's me. I've finished.
Great.
Thank you very much.
So essentially the children form two groups. So we have a group, you'll get to both do both the storytelling activity and the illustration activity. So don't worry if you're not immediately in the one that you want to do, because you'll get to do that afterwards. So if we could form our two groups, the drawing with Alan is over here, and the storytelling with Ian is over here on these very comfy looking cushions, Cambridge Reading Adventures cushions, which look very nice. So if we could split into two and join your group. Okay, thank you. And for the adults, there's a chance to grab some food. There's also the tour of the IOE, if you wish to participate. Sorry?
You're the first batch then. I want to show you some, where is he? That's Diego Fandango playing, I've got the book somewhere, hang on. Okay, here we go. So that's Diego Fandango, looks. And he forms a band. Am I going to talk to everybody at the same time? It's not going to be possible, is it? Hang on. Let me get rid of this. And this. I'll stand in the middle, shall I? I just wanted to show you a few things about animals. You maybe already started thinking about an animal that you fancy.
A cat.
A cat. And an instrument, right? So anyway, Diego Fandango, he's a banjo player. Here he is. So he plays the banjo. And he wants to get a band together, so he finds a hippo who plays the piano. Where's the one on the end? And then he finds a lemur, which is like a monkey, actually, that plays the drums. So he's got a piano player, and he's got a drummer, and he plays the banjo, and then he finds a lion who plays the trumpet. Now, when somebody says you've got to draw a picture of a lion playing a trumpet, you realize that they have problems, because first of all, they stand on four legs. So they haven't got a hand that can, if they try to play a trumpet, they fall over. So I tend to make the animals a bit more like people. There's a hippo, and she's standing up. So I find, you could try doing having an animal on four legs playing an instrument, but a cat would have a problem because he's on his paws. So if you stand the cat up, if you think of it like a person with a body and arms and legs and standing upright, and it's really just the head that makes it the animal. So anyway, there they are. They get the band together and then they have a big audience. So I also, just by chance, I happen to have another. So I don't know, here you go. Can you see me down there? Can you see this? You got the best view. You got the best view, really. I also had another thing that I did with animals playing instruments. So there's Diego Fandango playing the banjo. But I also had a horse playing a banjo. This wasn't in this story, it's in a different thing altogether. And this horse, Henry, there he is playing his banjo. And I like the fact that he's got no fingers. He's just got great big hooves. And he wouldn't really be able to play a banjo. He'd be making a real noise if you actually saw him playing that banjo. But also, I've got Barry, who's a sheep, and he's playing a piano. But what I added to him was I gave him a pair of dark glasses so he looked more like a pop star. And then I've got a hen playing a fiddle, a violin. And there's a duck playing a bass guitar. And there's a cow playing the drums. So you can have a look at these for different ideas, but every time you can see that I've stood them upright, because they can't play the instrument properly otherwise. So I'll make them seem a bit like people with an animal's head. But if you've got another idea, I'm really happy for you to do that. This is Barry. Hang on. That's what Barry looks like when he's a bit bigger. And there's Barry playing the piano. I'll pass these around, actually. You can have a look at them because it might give you an idea of what to do. I was going to do cutouts, and I don't know whether to do it. I think I'm just going to draw the pictures. Cutouts is a step too far, I think. We'll leave that. So, have you got anything? If you want to draw a rough one, you don't have to get it right first time. You can draw a rough one first, and then when you've got a vague idea that works, you can have another sheet of paper and start again and do a proper one. Or do the proper one if you're really clever. The reason I was working A4 was because I was going to do cutouts, but you can fill the whole page. Fill the whole page. You could do a whole band one day, but today we haven't got the time, so we're going to do one person playing one instrument. Unless you want to do two, I'm easy. So just think of an animal and then think of how they might hold the instrument. So what animal are you doing? Because I can see you've got an idea already, haven't you? A dog. What's the dog going to play? Have you got the instrument worked out? What is it? Okay. And do you know what electric, you know what it looks like? Have you got any thoughts? An animal? An instrument? You can think of something really weird. A teddy, is that a bear? Or a cat? That's a cat, I thought it was. But what's the cat going to play? A drum. Now you can have a drum with a kit and cymbals, or you can have a little African drum like this lemur was playing. There's those little drums there, look. Or you can have a big drum kit. It would be really good, but you might need to know what a drum kit looks like. And you know what, when I did Barry, right, here's Barry. Can I just have Barry a second, hang on. Oops. When I did Barry like that, what I actually did was I drew him like that. You see the parts, there's the piano, there's two arms, a head and a body. And then I cut them all out and then put them back together again so that it looked like that. Now, when you draw the guitar, you'll be able to see through the guitar, won't you? You could draw, you can have another piece of paper, you have as many as you like, so. That's exactly what I normally would do, yeah. That's the way I make animations. You could draw the guitar separately if you wanted to. And if I were you, I'd put the hands You can put the hands on, hang on, I'm going to tell these people up this end. You can put the hands separately, so you do the head on one part, a body on another. I'm going into cutouts now, I can see this is all going to go awry. That's the way I drew Barry. So I did the piano, then I drew his body. The reason I did this, this is how I make animations, this is how I make films. So I draw the instrument, draw the body. I know that doesn't look like a body, but it is, it really works. And then draw his head separately, because then I can turn his head if I want to. But what you have to do is you have to cut them all out.
And then you layer it over the top.
Yeah. So I don't mind if you draw it cut out. Am I confusing things here? That's quite complicated, but you do a big bass drum and two little drums, which just to really rect the little squares, because you don't see them from the side, and then you put a couple of cymbals on. Don't bother drawing all that complicated stuff. The big bass drum's the good one. That's the big, that's the really, that one there, look, the big black one.
That big one in the middle.
Because that's the big bass drum, the one that goes boof, boof with your foot pedal. Yeah. So, you could just, if you wanted to, you could draw it like I did, and you draw the head separately, and then we cut them out. And when you've cut them out, you then put them together on another sheet of paper. Me? I've got to sit there, apparently. No? You carry on. So hang on, let me just leave that one up the other end. Anyway, there's Barry taken apart, look. Great. Brilliant. So you're going to do a cutout. You're going to cut these out and put them together. So I think we'll all do cutouts. I think it's going to work. Because they're finding it hard to put the instrument in their hands. Okay. Is this shouting coming through the microphone, I wonder? Can you hear me talking? Am I shouting really loudly? I'm trying to make them hear me as well. They're more important. So, is that electric guitar? What instrument are you going to do? Have you had a thought? A what? A drum. Are you going to do like an African drum or one like up there? Because I can show you the kit. Do you know what the drum kit looks like? Try and a gorilla. Draw it as big as you can. See how big I've drawn Barry? You can start. See, what I did there, I cut his head out and then I put it on top of the body like that. There's the body. See, there's the body. And then I put it on top, and these arms are separate.
But how did you make it look more flat?
It's just the way I tend to draw it in the computer. I drew it on paper first, like you do.
And then you printed it out.
And then I scanned it into the computer.
I don't print it out.
I send the computer file. I don't need to print it out. I printed this out so you could see it. So, you've got... So, you could do his body separately if you want. You could draw his body over here. If you wanted to, you could draw him separately.
I don't know how to draw a dog's body.
A dog's body?
Yes.
Can I borrow your pencil? You see that? Where is it? That doesn't really look like a sheep's body, really. Well, it does, because that's the body. That works when you put that into the thing. So a body without a head, to be honest, is just really like that. Yeah, that's pretty much a dog's body. You'd have to draw it in scale to the same size, you know, so it fits with the size of his head. You could put a tail on it, so you know it's a dog. I've got to cycle around.
Yeah, that's sorry. It's quite close to that.
I seem to be, that's all right. How are we doing up here? So are you going to cut out the drums separately? Yep, great. He needs drumsticks. Don't forget his drumsticks. What are you doing?
Maracas. That's a good one.
Lovely, isn't it?
Yeah. And what's that? A tortoise. I've just drawn a tortoise for something else.
It's great. Would you like
is it a tortoise or is it a turtle? So you don't need to cut it out. You can just draw it like that. I like his face. Have you got a tortoise? No, nobody has a tortoise these days.
We did quite a lot on sea creatures earlier in the year, so we did quite a lot of work on tortoises. Yeah. Do you want them to colour in?
Yeah. Because there's supposed to be a competition, I think. And you could do a whole band. You could have a tortoise playing maracas, you could have another animal playing something else. And then you could put them all, you could cut them out, put them all together and make a band. Not today, because we haven't got the time. I don't know what you win. I just wanted to show you my tortoise. Look, I don't know if you can see this. It's a bit little. It'd be better on my iPad. So, here he is up here. Can you see it? This is a really big picture. See the tortoise? There's the tortoise, and he's got like another tortoise on his back. And then he's got another tortoise for an umbrella. Not very nice, that really. But that's a real one, a tortoise underneath. But he's not having to play the maracas, is he? So what are you doing? Piano. Is that a sheep as well? So it's a bit like Barry then. Great. So draw big, don't draw too little. You can draw quite big because you've got all this page and you can cut them out. Where'd you get that from? Ah. That's a good way of seeing a cat though. That's brilliant these days, isn't it? I never had that when I was at school. You can check everything. So are you doing a sheep as well? I actually I made that into a little piano instead of a big one. I'm just going to show the people down here. So there's animals playing different things. Who's doing the drum? You were doing the drum, weren't you? Because I've got the cow playing the drum. And you got, don't forget the drumsticks. And then I thought the cow has got problems because it hasn't got proper hands. So it kind of does it with these clunky things like that. I suppose the one the one danger is that you end up copying something instead of inventing it. You know, it's great. I think it's a great facility if you then think, well, I'm now going to do my own version, you know.
Maybe have a little look and then put the phone away till the
So I did my tortoise greenish as well. That's good. They are kind of greeny colour, aren't they? You can do the maracas really lots of different nice colours though, can't you? You could even do the shell, fancy colours if you want, because he might be a tortoise pop star, and he's got like a special shell. There's lots of colours. So what's the instrument you're going to do?
Drums.
You know you can draw them bigger though. You can fill this paper and cut them out if you want.
That's what I do.
Are you going to do some cutting out then? Or are you going to colour them first?
I'm going to cut them out and then colour them.
You might find it easier to colour them first. Why don't you quickly colour them in and then you could actually cut them out. Only because they keep still better when they're on a big sheet of paper. That's it, you can trace them. That's what I do.
I'm intrigued with the snake that's going to play the guitar because she gave up.
The snake?
Yeah, she had a snake and he's going to play the guitar. Look at his tail.
That would have been great.
I thought it would have been brilliant, but she's given up.
Is she giving up?
Yeah.
Oh, I missed that.
Yeah, sure.
I'd have encouraged her to do that.
Yeah, no, I came back to see if you could mix in.
Were you going to do a snake? Was it you going to do a snake? That would have been good. I don't know how we would... You'd have had to use his tail, wouldn't he? And then he would have had to... I'm going to have a go at that. You could try. That would be quite hard, though, wouldn't it? I don't blame you giving up. That's probably quite difficult. You could actually have... just working it roughly out. What would he do if he got like... I don't know where he'd... No, he can't. He can't do it. I was going to wrap him round the guitar, but then I thought he can't strum it, can he then?
Could he be like an hat, and then his tail?
He could use his tail just for the strumming. Or you could just give him two arms, and then he becomes a lizard. No, forget about it. From our body. Make your own type of cat, though. Draw big. Draw quite big, because then you can cut it out. So the bigger, the better. You see how big Barry was when I drew him on here, look? That's how big he needs to be. So his whole head can be that size. It changes the way you draw when you draw bigger. I don't know. It's not much time, is it?
I wonder whether we want to do a bigger version of this.
Yeah. One of the things I've often done is when you do, because usually I've done animation workshops, so they are cutting out in order to make an animation. We don't get around to actually shooting it, right? But once you've all cut them out, does anybody know when we're moving on?
I know it's not enough time.
No. I didn't think it was. I was going to drop the cutouts, and then they were having problems fitting the instruments.
Yeah.
Anyway. But that's great. And maracas, what a good idea, maracas. Have you got some bits cut out? You can stick the bits onto another sheet of paper with the... Let's cut that one. Do you want to cut that one out quickly? Because we've got 5 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. having a pot for. What do you think? Was the king very sad? The king got angry or something.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hello? Could we have a bit of silence at the back? Unfortunately, I think this is where we sort of draw a close to proceedings. Have you all enjoyed yourselves? Have you found out a lot about storytelling and illustrating? So which are you going to be, an author or an illustrator? Who's going to be an illustrator when they grow up? Oh. And who's going to be an author? Remember, we need at least one author for each illustrator, otherwise we'll have a fundamental imbalance. Okay? It looks like we've got a few more illustrators. Can I thank all of you for coming from Netley Primary School. It's been absolutely a joy to have you all, and I'm really pleased that you've all enjoyed the activities. And found out, and some of the Cambridge Reading Adventure books will be following you back to school, which will be very nice. I'd also just thank a few people, or many people in fact. This could be the longest thanks speech in the world, as there's been so many people involved in Cambridge Reading Adventures. So I will be slightly selective. First of all, could I thank Gemma Wickett, who's disappeared, but she's been with us working at the IUE pretty much from the start, and has been a great power for good in getting the Cambridge Reading Adventures moving. Also, ably assisted by Carla. I'd also like to really thank the wonderful team of authors and illustrators I've had the chance to work with. So here today we've got Alison and Gabby, who had played a key role in helping select and devise the sort of stories that we had, including the international schools and deciding which stories to pursue. To the illustrators, obviously Nick, John and Alan, a huge thanks. You're representative of quite a community of fantastic illustrators. Looking around the room, they are absolutely beautiful, the books, and that's a huge... yes. Particularly attractive illustrators, yes. So wonderful author team. Thanks also, though, to the team back in Cambridge, Sarah, who's worked tirelessly in helping produce the books, our design team with Nikki, who's here today, Nikki Kenwood. There's a long list, as I say, but it's invidious to leave people out. So Richard and Ginevra and Francesca and Tamsin and everyone who's come down from the Cambridge office. I'd like particular thanks for Catherine Harper and Nick Sean and Glenn who worked through some very difficult times in this last year to contribute to this amazing scheme. Our particular thanks and thoughts to them. But thank you all for attending. Thanks to Zoe, Alison, and the team for setting this wonderful event up. Cambridge Reading Adventures has now happened. For me, it's a sort of a dream come true, seeing all these wonderful books. I do hope you and all your fellow children will grow to love these books over the next few years. So a big thank you to everyone, and a big hand for all of us. Okay, thank you.